everyone. Welcome to the Maryland Historical Society's virtual program, Historic Amusement Parks in Maryland, Separate but Not Equal. My name is Martha Osterbiel, MDHS's Community Engagement Manager.
And I'm Margot Capera, the museum's Public Programs Manager. Today's thrill seekers flock to Six Flags or Disney World when they are open in search of lightning fast roller coasters and laser light shows. But how did these modern attractions come about? In just a few minutes, we'll learn about some of the nearly three dozen amusement parks scattered across Maryland's landscape over the past 144 years. For many, theme parks reconnect us to childhood, memories of relaxing family outings, thrilling rides, tasty food, and live entertainment.
These sentimental recollections, however, aren't held by all Marylanders. From their inception, amusement parks were racially segregated, with most operating under a whites-only admissions policy. The second of our program will narrow in on Gwynn Oak Park, a Baltimore County amusement park, which throughout the summer of 1963 was a site of protests and public demonstrations, eventually leading to the desegregation of the park. Gwynn Oak became one of the first Maryland amusement parks to desegregate and opened to all for the first time on August 28, 1963. We will learn more about the evolution of the Gwynn Oak protests and how they played a role in the greater civil rights movement.
Before we begin, we'd like to quickly run through a few webinar logistics. In order to run a smooth live program, we have disabled your audio and video capabilities. We would still love for you to engage with us and other attendees throughout the program by using the chat function icon at the bottom of your screen. Give it a try now and let us know where you are watching from today.
Furthermore, if you have any questions for our panelists or for me and Margot at any point throughout the next hour, please type them into the Q&A box, also located at the bottom of your screen. We'll leave some time at the end of the program to address a few of them. And lastly, we want to let you know that this program is being recorded. You'll all receive a link to watch it in a follow-up email sometime next week.
So I see all of you are in our chat and telling us where you're calling from or where you're viewing us from today. California, Westminster, Baltimore, Glen Arm, all over the place. So thank you and welcome all of you. Without further ado, let's introduce our guests. Jason Rhodes is an award-winning journalist and photographer, and is the author of Images of America, Maryland's Amusement Parks. His other works include a travel guide and visual history of his native Somerset County on Maryland's Eastern Shore. He currently works as the public relations director and university spokesman at Salisbury University. So welcome, Jason.
Amy Nathan is also an award-winning author of nonfiction books for young people and adults. They cover a wide range of topics, including women's history, civil rights, dance, and music. Amy is a graduate of Baltimore City's Western High School, and she holds a bachelor's degree in history from Harvard University, a master's of arts in teaching, also from Harvard, and a master's from Columbia's Teachers College. She lives in Westchester County, New York. I'm Amy.
And Sharon Langley is also a Baltimore native who became known as the first African-American child to ride on the carousel at Gwynn Oak Park when it opened to all in August of 1963. She has a background in elementary literacy and works as an educational consultant, providing instructional coaching to teachers and administrators in Southern California. She is a graduate of Clark Atlanta University and holds a master's degree in educational leadership from Mount St. Mary's University. She lives and writes in Los Angeles, and that is where she is joining us from today. Welcome, Sharon.
And Sharon and Amy are co-authors of a recently published children book, A Ride to Remember, a civil rights story, the history of which is told in more detail in Amy's earlier book for teens and adults, Round Together.
Yes, and we are so thrilled that all of you are here. Welcome to the Maryland Historical Society virtually, and thank you for joining us and offering your expertise on this topic. So, let's get started. Jason, could you please walk us through Maryland's historic amusement parks?
I'd love to. And the first thing I'm going to do is share my screen. So if everybody could bear with us for just a moment, hopefully we'll have some visuals up. All right. Hopefully what everybody sees is the cover of my book. And if that's not what everybody is seeing, then Martha or Margo, chime in and let me know.
Looks great.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you everybody for joining us. I am Jason Rhodes. I'm the author of Maryland's Amusement Parks, which was published in 2005 by Arcadia Publishing. For the purpose of the book and for the purpose of this presentation, we're going to define amusement park as a park with traditional or mechanical rides, like roller coasters or carousels, not pleasure beaches, which was more bathhouses and bathing suits and things of that nature, which sometimes in the early part of the 20th century were also referred to as amusement parks. In researching the book, I found that there were more than 40 amusement parks in Maryland that operated at various times from the late 1800s to the present. And today we're going to touch on just about all of them in 20 minutes or less. We'll start with the ones that we don't have images for or that we don't have a whole lot of information for. The first one is Bethesda Park. That was a 50-acre trolley park that opened in 1891 in Bethesda. It burned to the ground in 1894 in an electrical fire. Notley Hall Amusement Park was an African-American amusement park in Prince George's County that operated from 1894 to 1924. And in 1911, it was renamed Washington Park, and that was a steamboat park on the Potomac River. Hollywood Park opened in the early 1900s on Back River in Baltimore. Lakeside Park was a trolley park that opened in the early 1900s on Lake Roland in northern Baltimore. Wonderland Park was also a park in Baltimore that we don't have a whole lot of records on today. Asbury Park was a small amusement park in Crisfield on the Eastern Shore that opened in about 1915, and it burned in a fire in 1918. Today, a small portion of the concrete floor from the dance hall and skating rink from that park still exists in a farm pasture down in Crisfield. Hastings Electric Park was another amusement park in Crisfield. It operated on Cove Street from the late teens into the 1920s. Bay Ridge Park was located in Crisfield as well in what's known as the Lavalette section. It opened in 1930 and closed in 1932 after the death of one of its principal owners. A lot of the structures from the park remained, but they were torn up and washed away by Hurricane Hazel in 1954. And with that, we'll move on to the rest of Maryland's amusement parks, geographically roughly from northwest to southeast. And that starts with Penmar Park. A lot of post-World War II amusement parks, or a lot of pre-World War II amusement parks, I should say, were owned and operated by train, trolley, and steamboat companies as destinations to draw passengers to its terminus points. So if you owned a trolley company or a steamboat company and you wanted to give passengers a reason to use your services, you gave them a place to go at the end of your line. So Penmar Park was opened by Western Maryland Railroad Company in Cascade, Maryland on the Pennsylvania border in 1877. It was sold in 1930 and then ceased operation in 1943 as the U.S. became involved in World War II. Now, the mechanical elements of the park are gone, but in 1977, Washington County reopened the park with its natural elements, which included a spring and an observation post, as a county-operated park. Braddock Heights Park was very similar to Penmar Park. It was founded as a summer resort in Frederick County in 1896, and it, too, closed at the onset of World War II in 1943. In Monrovia, Adventure Park USA opened in 2005. It is one of the handful of amusement parks that's still open today in Maryland. In Montgomery County, Glen Echo Park was founded in 1899 when the National Chautauqua Assembly leased its property to the Glen Echo Company. The park was soon purchased by the Washington Railway and Electric Company and ran as a trolley park. Trolley service to the park continued until 1960. That same year, protesters began to demand desegregation at the park. The park did desegregate in 1961, but it couldn't keep up with the national parks that had popped up since then, like Disneyland, Freedom Land in New York, Six Flags Over Texas, and eventually it didn't have the draw that some of these bigger parks did, and it closed in 1968. But that's not the end of the Glen Echo Park story. The National Park Service took over the park lands in 1971 and repurposed some of its structures, like this bumper car pavilion, and uses it today for programming and rental use. The park's carousel is still in operation there today as well. Cabin John Park opened in 1876 as part of the Cabin John Hotel Resort in Montgomery County, and it operated sporadically until 1910. Riverview on the Potomac was a park that opened in the early 1900s in Prince George's County. Kittyland opened on New Hampshire Avenue and Tacoma Park in 1960 and operated until 1971. And after World War II, you saw a lot of these types of kitty parks popping up to serve the baby boom population. Wild World was part of a trend in the 1970s. A lot of TV production companies got into themed entertainment, and a lot of them were unsuccessful experiments. Wild World may or may not have been an exception, depending on your point of view. It opened in Largo as the Largo Wildlife Reserve Drive-Thru Safari in 1974 after ABC Television purchased a plot of land that it sits on from billionaire Ross Perot. In 1978, ABC sold the park to Jim Fowler, who was the host of Wild Kingdom, Mutual of Omaha, and he renamed it Wild World after Wild Kingdom, operated it for a couple of years, sold it in 1980 to developers who reopened the park in 1982 as a combination animal park and amusement park with the purchase of rides, including this carousel. And then they added a water park in 1983, and that really became the park's big draw for the next decade or so, but the amusement park was still built up during that time. In 1992, the park was sold again and became Adventure World. They added rides like the Typhoon Sea Coaster seen here. And then in 1998, Premier Parks, which was a regional park chain, purchased the Six Flags brand from Time Warner and sort of went on a spending spree. They bought up a lot of regional parks, including Adventure World, and rebranded them with the Six Flags name. Obviously, Six Flags America is still operating in Largo today. What you're seeing here is the Wild One, which was a wooden roller coaster built at Paragon Park in Massachusetts in 1917 and relocated to what was then Wild World in 1986. It is the second oldest wooden roller coaster still in operation in the U.S., so historically significant. Moving on to the Baltimore parks, Electric Park was opened by United Railways and Electric Company near the intersections of Belvedere Avenue and Reisterstown Road in 1896. Its biggest attraction was electricity. All of its buildings were covered in twinkling lights, thousands of them. It was certified as some important firsts in Maryland. It was the first location in Maryland that showed a motion picture and the first location in Maryland to host an automobile race. Unfortunately, rising property values made the insurance increase, and the insurance increases made the park unprofitable by 1915, so the owners demolished it and sold the property in 1916. This is Dreamland Park in Baltimore. Now, we don't know a whole lot about Dreamland Park. This is actually the only image I've ever seen of it, and you'll see that it depicts what's called the Fish House. So the Fish House was probably a nautical-themed fun house or dark ride, which is like a tunnel of love or a haunted house. To the left, you see a building that says the Haunted Swing. The Haunted Swing is a ride with you sit inside on a bench and the room looks like it's turning around and spinning around upside down. There are still a few haunted swings left in the U.S. today, but at the time, it was a pretty common novelty at amusement parks. Riverview Park opened in 1890 at Point Breeze in Baltimore. It was one of Baltimore's most popular parks at the time. This park, too, was later purchased by the United Railways and Electric Company, which billed it as the Coney Island of the South. United Railways sold the property to Western Electric to build a new power plant in 1929, and they got out just in time because just weeks after the sale went through, the Great Depression started with the stock market crash. So they got a lot more for the property than they probably would have otherwise. Liberty Heights Park was opened in 1919 by entrepreneur John Carlin. This really became the crown jewel of Baltimore area amusement parks. Now, to distinguish the park from the Liberty Heights neighborhood, because when people said, I'm going to Liberty Heights, he wanted them to say, well, I'm going to Liberty Heights Park, or I'm just going to the Liberty Heights neighborhood. Nobody was doing that. So he wanted to brand the park a little better. He also wanted a shorter name, so he didn't have to pay for quite as much lettering and advertising. So he renamed it after himself, Carlin's Park. The park continued for several years after his death in 1954. Unfortunately, the park's ice rink, which was a big draw, burned down in 1956, and attendance really fell off after that. The park tried to hang on by competing as the site for the new Baltimore Civic Center when bids were put in 1958. Unfortunately, Carlins was not afforded the bid, and the park closed for good at the end of that season. Bayshore Park was another popular park, opened in 1906 by the United Railways and Electric Company. In addition to traditional amusements, it offered water attractions, taking advantage of its position on the bay. What you see here is the water swing, so people would swing out into the water and then jump off. In 1944, the park was sold to one of its ride operators, George Mahoney. He sold the park to real estate developers in 1946, and in 1947, those developers flipped the property to Bethlehem Steel as the site of a new steel plant. Not one to be deterred, George Mahoney took advantage of the closure of the park and built Bay Island Beach nearby on Pleasure Island. Sometimes people refer to this as the new Bayshore Park. The initial attractions included a roller coaster and a small midway. By 1958, all of that had closed, and he operated it purely as a pleasure beach. In 1960, he sold it to real estate developers, and history repeated itself. In 1964, they sold the park to Bethlehem Steel to build another steel plant. This is Eastern Amusement Park in Baltimore. I don't have a whole lot of information on this park, but we do know that it operated in the 1930s on Eastern Avenue in Baltimore. Frederick Road Park opened in 1920 on Frederick Road in Baltimore. It's another park that we don't know a whole lot about, but we do know that it featured this Philadelphia Toboggan Company carousel, as well as a roller coaster called the Deep Dipper and a dance hall called the Palace of Jazz. Now, the 1970s saw other trends in amusement parks. One was the experimental idea of indoor-themed attractions. They built these as theme parks, although the attractions usually relied less on traditional rides and more on mechanical shows and hands-on activities focusing on a central theme. In 1985, hopping on this trend, Six Flags opened the Power Plant in Baltimore's Inner Harbor. This is the inside of the Power Plant, one of the mechanical shows. The idea was that visitors would see a series of these shows that followed the journey of Dr. Phineas T. Flagg and his many inventions, including an attempt to build an energy source large enough to power the world, hence the Power Plant. The park was not profitable and it closed in 1989, but the idea of these themed entertainment venues lives on in places today like Chuck E. Cheese on a much smaller scale. The Enchanted Forest opened in Ellicott City 1 month after Disneyland in 1955, and it was billed as the first theme park on the East Coast. Its opening was covered by NBC television on the Today Show, and it began with mostly static fairy tale tableaus created by Howard Adler of the Adler Display Studio. Later on, it expanded to include several dark rides, including Alice in Wonderland and some non-fairy tale rides like a Jungleland Safari. It closed in 1988, and in 1992, became the Enchanted Forest Shopping Center. You see old King Cole on the sign. He used to point visitors into the park. Now he points them into Safeway. The remaining portion of the park that was not built over with the shopping center opened for one more season in 1994 and then closed forever. The park remained abandoned until 2005, and you can see poor Willie the Whale here isn't looking so hot. There was a lot of vandalism, there was a lot of deterioration, and the park became popular for filmmakers as a desolated amusement park or a deteriorated area. So it made some appearances in movies like John Waters' Crybaby and on TV shows like Homicide: Life on the Street. In 2003, the Enchanted Forest Preservation Society was formed to save the remaining parts of the park. And in 2005, Clark's Elio Farm, which was a nearby educational farm and petting zoo sort of place, received permission to remove the remaining salvageable structures. And they were renovated through years of grant writing and volunteer efforts. And today, the Enchanted Forest at Clark's Elio Farm remains a popular attraction in Ellicott City. And you can see Willie the Whale is looking much happier here. Carr's Beach was an African-American amusement park established in Anne Arundel County in 1926 in response to the segregated beach resorts in Southern Maryland. They had rides, but the real draw there was live music by nationally known African-American recording artists. Now, the dance hall held up to 8,000 people, and they learned that the hard way, because in 1956, when Chuck Berry came to play a show, 70,000 people showed up, and they had to cut them off after the first 8,000 got in because there simply wasn't room. In the 1960s, new owners purchased the park and the Pleasure Beach and desegregated. The final performance at the dance hall was Frank Zappa, which is about as far away as you can get from Chuck Berry. In 1973, and then Cars Beach closed in 1974. The Chesapeake Beach Resort was founded in 1900 by the Chesapeake Beach Railway Company, and it also serves as a steamboat park, so it was a double threat. It got its visitors from the trolleys and the steamboats. It incorporated into Seaside Park in 1930, and you can see that they had the little miniature train bringing guests in from the steamboats. The park closed after the 1942 season, as with many of the other parks we talked about, on the onset of World War II. In 1945, it reopened as Chesapeake Beach Park, and it continued in under that name until 1972, when the park property was sold to real estate developers for housing. Marshall Hall Park was a recreation area founded as a steamboat park with natural attractions near Bryans Road, Maryland, in Charles County in 1889. The amusement park was built in the 1920s, operated for many years. In 1977, a storm with tornado force winds destroyed the wooden roller coaster and some of the other rides and structures. The park could not afford to rebuild. It continued operating for a couple of years with the remaining rides, but without the coaster and some of the bigger rides, the draw just wasn't there, so it closed in 1980. White Crystal Beach opened as a beach resort in Cecil County on the Elk River in the 1930s. Its owners had run a traveling carnival and some small amusement parks in Delaware and New Jersey, so they put that expertise to use and opened a small amusement park at the beach resort with rides like this kiddie coaster. Unfortunately, much of the park and much of the resort was destroyed by Hurricane Hazel in 1954, and then just for good measure, most of the rest of it burned in a fire in 1955. Colchester Beach opened in 1877 near Rock Hall in Kent County as a steamboat park with natural attractions. Soon they added some mechanical rides like a hand-powered carousel, which by 1888 was converted to be driven by donkeys. And then they added other mechanical attractions like the Tickler, which you see here, starting in the 1900s. And the Tickler was what we know as a Virginia reel ride. Riders would ride up the right-hand side in a tub and follow those rails down in the tub. Unfortunately, the friction in a lot of those Virginia reel rides caused fires, and many of them burned down, and in short time they were no longer a popular amusement park ride because of that. But at one time they were the pinnacle of amusement park rides in many areas. The most interesting amusement park exhibit at Colchester, and probably any amusement park in Maryland, came in 1889 with the Colchester Beach Whale. This was an actual embalmed whale that was captured off the coast of Cape Cod and exhibited at the park for one season. Visitors could pay to climb the steps and look into its mouth. Or you could wait until one of the local organizations held special events like ladies' teas or men's oyster suppers, and you could dine inside the whale. They would set tables and chairs up right on the whale's tongue. Now, not because of the whale, but many years later, the Colchester Beach Park closed in 1962, and it too has been redeveloped into residential property. Central Park, we talked about three parks in Crisfield earlier. Central Park was the fourth. It opened off of what is now Main Street Extended at the end of World War II. Some of the rides at the park we think were probably left over from Hastings Park. This gaming wheel that's being held by Dora Sterling, who had relatives who worked at the park, represents one of the few remaining pieces of the park today, and it closed in the mid-1950s. Well, in the 1950s, Westerns were all the rage on TV, and a lot of Western theme parks popped up to take advantage. In 1960, Frontier Town started as a park to take advantage of that trend. You see the Gunfighters, which was a main attraction. They had Native American dancers and a saloon show. The buildings and tableaus were designed by Howard Adler of the Adler Display Studio, just like the Enchanted Forest. And Frontier Town, as many of you who visit Ocean City will know, still remains in operation today. Tremper's Luna Park came about following a 1900 hurricane, which destroyed the Seabright Hotel at what is now the Ocean City Inlet. The hotel's owners, Daniel and Margaret Tremper, rebuilt the venue as the Windsor Resort, which was themed after Windsor Castle near London. Upgrades included a small movie theater and the addition of Tremper's Luna Park, which you see here. Of course, the park has expanded greatly over the years and is now Tremper's Rides. The hurricane that created the inlet in 1933 damaged a lot of Luna Park and most of the park's rides. They rebuilt, and 130 years later, you can still visit Tremper's Rides. One of the rides that did not get damaged in that 1933 storm was the park's 1912 Herschel Spillman Carousel. And today that continues as one of the oldest continuously operating carousels in the US. Now the Tremper family branched out from Tremper's Rides over the years. In 2005, a member of the Tremper family opened Tremper's Buckaroo Park next door to Frontier Town. It closed in 2006. It featured 13 rides and 10 games. It was mostly a kiddie park, and the main attraction was the Pixie Plaza, which is what you're looking at here. Pixie Plaza featured 6 kiddie rides connected to a central hub, and only 7 were built in the early 1970s. Ocean Playland is another park in Ocean City. It opened in 1965 to capitalize on the expanding development in Ocean City as the first high-rise hotels were beginning to rise north of the boardwalk. And later on, the name shortened to just Playland. Most of the rides were carnival-style rides initially, owned by and operated by concessionaires, but as the park matured, it bought out the rides or brought in their own, and by its final season in 1980, it had a total of 42 rides. After the 1980 season, facing increased competition for tourist dollars, the park's owners accepted an offer from the town of Ocean City to buy the property and turn it into a public transportation maintenance and fueling facility. So that's where the buses parked after the theme park went away. Like Playland, Jolly Roger opened in Ocean City in 1965 to take advantage of the sprawling north development. Its original focus was mainly on golf. It had an honored Arnold Palmer driving range and a miniature golf course. Just had 6 amusement park rides. That has expanded greatly over the years. Today, Jolly Roger is one of the biggest tourist attractions in Ocean City. It includes a water park and a go-kart track, as well as the original amusement park. The success of Trimpers and other boardwalk concessionaires led to more and more amusements being set up along the Ocean City boardwalk, and one of the most lucrative locations was out on the Ocean City Pier. In 1975, Buddy Jenkins, who owned Jolly Roger, bought the pier attractions, and today that park operates as Jolly Roger at the Pier, so it's the sister park. And then we'll go back to Baltimore. So back in Baltimore, Gwynn Oak Park opened in Woodlawn in 1893, beginning its run as one of the longest operating amusement parks in Maryland. By the 1900s, the park's feature attraction was the Diff Racer roller coaster, which you'll see here looked pretty thrilling for its time. By 1910, the park had also added a carousel from the Artistic Carousel Manufacturing Company, and you'll see how ornate that was and that it wasn't just horses. In the 1940s, the park also offered live animal attractions like these carts that were pulled by goats. The park also hosted many special events. This 1906 balloon ascension was part of a trend of balloon and dirigible ascensions at parks in the early part of the 1900s. For those that wanted to get off the ground themselves, the park later offered this aero swing, and of course it had other traditional rides like a Ferris wheel and a whip. And just to show you how the park modernized with the times, this picture from 1905 shows the park shooting gallery, and you take a look at the sign. It says rifle practice, a scientific amusement. Well, by the early 1960s, there was a TV show called The Rifleman that was very popular. So the shooting gallery became the Rifleman's Range, and the Rifleman starred Chuck Connors, who you can see depicted up in the upper left-hand corner of the sign. Unfortunately, one thing that did not change over most of the years that the park was open was its segregation policies. It was a whites-only amusement park, and in 1955, some of the local churches began calling for segregation at the park, or desegregation, I should say, at the park. In July 1963, as the civil rights movement was gaining momentum throughout the U.S., 2 demonstrations thrust Gwynn Oak Park into the national spotlight. The first was symbolically held on Independence Day, July 4th. It was peaceful, but it resulted in 283 arrests. Then there was a second demonstration on July 7th, and unfortunately that was met with a counter-protest. That resulted in a handful of minor injuries and 94 more arrests, and it created some worries among local officials that further protests might turn tragic. So local officials sat down and discussed the situation with the park. And then on August 28, 1963, 2 historic events took place in the Baltimore-Washington corridor. In Washington, D.C., the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave his I Have a Dream speech. And in Woodlawn, Charles Langley Jr. took his 11-month-old daughter, Sharon, on a ride on the Gwynn Oak Park Carousel, officially marking the park's desegregation. And we'll hear more from Sharon about her historic ride in just a few minutes. But first, I want to share just a little more information about the legacy of her historic moment. In 1981, the 1940s Alan Herschel Carousel that Sharon rode that day was moved to the National Mall in Washington, D.C., where it still operates today, with a plaque that denotes its historical significance. In 1988, filmmaker John Waters wrote a fictionalized account of the July 1963 demonstrations into his hit movie Hairspray, where Gwynn Oak was given the screen name Tilted Acres. And in 2013, a 50th anniversary march at the former site of Gwynn Oak Park was held to commemorate the demonstrations that led to the park's desegregation. And those in attendance included some of the demonstrators who had marched on the park a half century earlier. Now, throughout the 1960s, due to some trends that we'll talk about in a few minutes in amusement parks, attendance at Gwynn Oak Park began to decline. It still remained profitable, but not as profitable as it had been in the 40s and 50s. And then in June 1972, Hurricane Agnes destroyed 40% of the park's rides, causing about $900,000 worth of damage. Its owners were unable to secure a loan to repair the damage or purchase new rides. So after trying to make one more go of it, the park closed in 1973 after 80 years of operation. Now, some of those changes that were taking place in the amusement park industry was a shift from regional theme parks like Gwynn Oak to super regional or semi-national theme parks. Busch Gardens and King's Dominion had both been announced for Virginia. They were going to open in 1975. Great Adventure Theme Park, which is a Six Flags park today, was announced to be opened in 1974 in New Jersey. And the thought was that a lot of these larger, more modern theme parks were going to be drawing customers away in droves from the remaining community parks like Gwynn Oak. So when they auctioned off the remaining rides in 1974, it didn't draw a whole lot of interest. And the park's owners were very vocal about their displeasure with that in news articles like this one from the Evening Sun. They only raised about $415,000 from the auction, and that wasn't even enough to pay off their $500,000 mortgage on the property. Today, the grounds on which Gwynn Oak Park once sat still remain open as a recreational park operated by Baltimore County, so you can still see where the park was. You just can't ride the rides anymore. I hope you've enjoyed this quick look at the history of Maryland amusement parks. And if anyone has any questions, I think we'll have time for some brief questions and answers at the end. But at this point, I'll turn it back over to Martha and Margot.
Thanks so much, Jason. That was a vast amount of information, and we really appreciate you sharing that research that you've done with us. We will see you again for those Q&A rounds at the end. We have a couple of great questions that were posed, so we're looking forward to you answering those for us later. I'd like to bring Amy and Sharon back on. They're going to talk a little bit more about the evolution of the protests at Gwynn Oak Park and specifically how children are important to social change and kind of the impact and the significance that holds. So I will say goodbye and we'll let Amy and Sharon take the stage.
Yes, thank you, Jason, for giving all that wonderful history. And Sharon and I both grew up in Baltimore, but we didn't meet as children. We didn't connect until 2008, after I read this book, Here Lies Jim Crow, which talks about segregation in Maryland. And I saw this picture in the book of Sharon's ride, the one that Jason just showed you. There were only a few sentences in the book about the ride, and I usually write books for young people, and I thought this would make a great story for children. So I tracked down Sharon in California, I phoned her, and I tried to find out her recollections and her family's recollections of that photograph and asked if it would be all right with her if I did some research and wrote a book about it. And she said, go right ahead. And so that led to this book, Round and Round Together, which is a book for teens and adults, because as I did more and more research, I saw that the story of Gwynn Oak and Sharon's ride really could give an overview of the civil rights movement as a whole up until the mid-1960s. So today I'm going to give you just a quick rundown of some of the amazing historical information that I found out in doing this research about Gwynn Oak Amusement Park and the new carousel that arrived there in 1947. And as Jason pointed out, and as you can see from these photos, it was a segregated whites-only park from its beginning in 1894. And the park itself, the story of the park parallels the story of the Jim Crow segregation era, because 2 years after it opened in 1896, was the Plessy versus Ferguson Supreme Court decision, which gave the Supreme Court's stamp of approval to segregation. But the idea of separate but equal, that it was okay to have separate facilities for African Americans as long as they were equal to those provided for whites. But as we all know, they were never equal. But as I make a big point of in the book, people protested against Jim Crow right from the start. And the book includes a lot of information about protests in Maryland during the years after the Plessy decision. But for something really major to happen that had a direct impact on Gwynn Oak, it was the 1954 Brown versus Board of Education decision, which overturned the Plessy versus Ferguson decision of separate but equal. And Baltimore and DC were two of the first Southern cities to go along with the Board of Education, the Brown decision, and officially desegregate their schools. And the very next year, protests began at Gwynn Oak Amusement Park. Now you might wonder why you would protest at an amusement park when there were so many other important issues to deal with. Well, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Gave a reason why even protesting in amusement parks was important. Because as he said in his letter from Birmingham City Jail, when you find your tongue twisted and your speech stammering as you seek to explain to your six-year-old daughter why she can't go to the amusement park that has just been advertised on television, and see tears welling up in her little eyes when she is told that Funtown is closed to colored children, and see the depressing clouds of inferiority begin to form in her little mental sky, then you will understand why we find it difficult to wait. And the idea of preventing those clouds of inferiority forming in little mental skies was one of the chief arguments that won the Brown versus Board of Education decision. For that reason, and also for the reason of a survey that was done by the Baltimore Sun in March of 1955, that despite the Brown Board of Education decision, 91% of businesses in Baltimore were still segregated, including Gwynn Oak. And so the first protest happened in Gwynn Oak in September 1955, this is 3 months before Dr. King made his first appearance as a civil rights leader with the Montgomery bus boycott. But that first protest didn't work. The protests were organized by CORE, an interracial group called the Congress of Racial Equality that really believed in Gandhi's ideas of nonviolent protest. And so they learned the nonviolent part of their protest strategies quite well, but it took them a while to learn how to have more effective protests. So for the next 7 years, their protests usually happened just once a year. They were pretty small, just a few dozen people protesting outside the amusement park. They didn't know how to get good press coverage. So there was no drama, no crisis, no reason for the amusement park to change its strategies. But gradually, Baltimore CORE and Morgan State College students learned about the more effective strategies that were going on down south with the Montgomery bus boycott, the lunch counter sit-ins in North Carolina, and the Freedom Rides in 1961. And these more effective strategies, and this is how this book Run Around Together and the whole story also in the picture book can help readers today connect with what's going on in the United States today to think about different strategies that can be used in a protest and what is actually effective. So they learned the more effective strategies of having lots of protesters, getting good newspaper and particularly TV coverage, and inflicting some economic pain on the segregators. Persistence, not just protesting once a summer, creating a sense of crisis, that was really important to Gandhi's ideas, and mass arrests. And these strategies came to Baltimore thanks to young people, primarily Morgan State College students, who teamed up with CORE members to hold sit-ins at restaurants in Baltimore and up and down Route 40 from 1961 to 63, just about every weekend. And they also learned from the more successful protests that were done at Glen Echo Park outside of Washington, where protests also started in 1960 on a carousel, but they were persistent. They held protests every day that summer until the park agreed to desegregate. And one of the persons who was influenced by the Howard protesters, Walter P. Carter, who was getting his master's degree at Howard. He was a social worker in Baltimore, and he soon became the head of Baltimore CORE and decided to bring in these more activist strategies. But Morgan State College students really showed Baltimore how to have an activist protest with their protest at Northwood Movie Theater in the spring of 1963, when more than 1,500 protesters showed up. Over 350 were arrested, totally clogged the Baltimore prisons. And at the same time as working on protests like Gwynn Oak, activists were actively registering Black voters, and the Black voting power in Maryland became very important. In fact, it's thought that Jack Kennedy would never have become president without winning the Black vote in Maryland. And there was a mayoral election coming up. The mayor knew he needed the Black vote, so he put pressure on the movie theater, and within a week, the movie theater caved in and opened to all. So Baltimore Court decided to use all these strategies that summer in Baltimore, choosing a much more newsworthy day to have its first protest, July 4th. And they worked very hard getting a lot of co-sponsors with all the major religious groups in Baltimore, Catholic, Protestant, and Jewish, labor unions, all the different civil rights groups joined together to have these protests, student groups, professors. And both the first and second protests, nearly 400 were arrested, including 20 clergy. And this was a first for the civil rights movement to have so many clergy arrested at any one particular demonstration, particularly white clergy, as the New York Times pointed out. So all this press coverage, a lot of press coverage and newspaper and TV coverage, including one, and I hope she's here today. We invited her to come today. Lydia Wilkins, this is the news story in the center, is Lydia Wilkins at age 11, and the other children also participated in the protest. And she and her aunt were recruited by the Afro-American newspaper to try to slip into the park on the day of the second protest before the protest started, because they were very fair complexion. And they figured the ticket takers would be so worried about the protest, they wouldn't really look at anyone very carefully when they signed up to buy tickets, and that was true. So Lydia and her aunt got into the park and they went on some rides. They stayed for about an hour. They came out and told their story to the Afro reporter who wrote up this story. So all this press coverage of children and clergy being arrested really caused a lot of outcry in the Baltimore area against the park, and the negotiations were started and agreed to end segregation on August 28th. And that's when little Sharon Langley and her parents came to Gwynn Oak as the first African-American family to enter the park that day. And he took Sharon to ride on the carousel. And the next day, there were newspaper stories about Sharon's ride, about white children riding along with her on the carousel, everybody getting along just fine, which seemed to be a feel-good story, but also reflect what Dr. King was talking about at his March on Washington, that he hoped one day little Black boys and Black girls will be able to join hands and treat each other as brothers and sisters. So as Jason explained, that the park had some financial difficulties, primarily because many white customers refused to come once the park had desegregated. But what really did the park in was Hurricane Agnes, which caused the park to close permanently, but a concessionaire from the Smithsonian bought the carousel, moved it to the National Mall in 1981. Now, he did not know the story of Sharon's ride, nor did the Smithsonian, nor did the National Park Service until my book came out. But when it came out, they were just really thrilled by this story. They figured out which horse little Sharon had ridden in 1963. They redecorated it with the name of civil rights heroes, and even put Sharon's name on the back of the saddle and on one of the horseshoes. And as Jason explained, there's now a historical marker at the carousel, and there's also a historical marker at the site of the old amusement park. And there's Sharon, who came to that festival in 2013. And that's where she and I met for the first time in person and decided to start work on this wonderful picture book that she's going to tell you more about now. Now I'll stop sharing. Yes.
All right, so thank you so much for joining us today. You've gotten a lot of history about amusement parks and particularly the history of Gwynn Oak Amusement Park. Amy, my name is Sharon Langley, and Amy showed you a great walk through the history of Gwynn Oak and its integration. And I just want to say that she and I had been speaking on the phone, I think, for about 3 or 4 years, periodically stopping to interview and allowing me to share the information that my family shared with me about our participation at Gwynn Oak. As she mentioned to you, A Ride to Remember is the picture book version of Gwynn Oak's integration. Round and Round Together has been used for supplemental reading for middle school and high school young adult readers because it does tell the story more comprehensively and definitely for older readers. But A Ride to Remember focuses really on the events at Gwynn Oak and told for younger readers and their families. Our book is illustrated by Floyd Cooper, who is an award-winning illustrator. And at the time that we were working on the manuscript, it was very important to me that the illustrator be the kind of illustrator who provided warm and inviting images, because we were actually going to be talking about segregation and excluding people. And the experience of being discriminated against. So I felt that having an illustrator with such a warm delivery would make it easier for families to enter into the story and to have the discussion about segregation and to realize that in 1963, that was really not a very long time ago. And so we think about instances of segregation in modern life. And then we think later on, as we finish the story, we start to think about what are the roles that families and children can play in making change in their community. So this is one of the opening pages from the book. And it's told in my voice as my family and I are discussing Gwynn Oak. When I was a very little girl, I lived in Baltimore, and near our house was an amusement park. It was green and grassy, big and beautiful, bright and shiny. And there were rides and games and treats and cold drinks at Gwynn Oak, and a carousel too. But before I was born, there were no rides or sweets at that park for children like me. Was it because families didn't have money to go? No, that wasn't the reason. Well, then what was the reason? Because of an unfair rule that the park had, that African Americans couldn't go on any of the rides. Could we have gone to have a picnic? I asked. No, we couldn't. Well, that's terrible. Yes, it was. It was segregation, keeping people apart because of their race, and treating people differently because of the color of their skin. What about the golden rule? What about treating other people the way you want to be treated? I guess some people forgot that the golden rule is supposed to include everyone. And I want to just share that these are excerpts from the book. This is not the book in its entirety, but it does lead us to think about how do we explain things in society, whether in the past or presently, how do we explain things that are unfair or unjust? And how do we help students have a sense, or children, how do we have them have a sense of agency, that they too have a part to play, that they are able to look at the world around them and decide what they will accept and what they won't accept, and what will they be willing to help make a change. So here's Sharon questioning again. Why didn't somebody do something about those kinds of laws? They did, said Mama. We did, said Daddy. Many people, both blacks and whites, knew that segregation was unfair and just plain wrong. Some people said, just wait, times will change. But others said, why wait? What's wrong with now? And they held protests at restaurants and stores and movie theaters. They tried to get officials and courts to make new laws to create a better city, a place that would welcome and include all people. So by the time I was born, some unfair laws had started to change in Baltimore, but the amusement park just wouldn't budge. And so this talks about the protest at Gwynn Oak on July 4th. And Mama says in the story, what day do you think they chose? July 4th. That's right, a day that stands for freedom. Did they have fireworks? Oh, they had something even better. Hundreds of people, black and white, young and old, students, teachers, priests, ministers, and rabbis, all came together on July 4th, 1963, to take part in one of the biggest protests the city had ever had. They believed in the golden rule, that being fair is the right thing to do. First, the protesters went to a church to pray, to sing freedom songs and get ready. They spent the morning learning how to be peaceful protesters and not use their fists to fight back. They climbed onto buses to go to the amusement park, and they brought signs and banners that declared their message of fairness for all. And you can see that although the protesters here were vocal and used their freedom songs as an anthem to bring them and their cause together, you can see that there were some who did not agree. And unfortunately, when they tried to enter the park, they were arrested. So they did what they'd been taught to do. Some people sat down on the ground and refused to move, and the police officers had to carry them to buses to take them to the police station. Almost 300 people were arrested that day. Some people paid their fine and could go home, but half of them refused to pay their fines, and they chose to spend the night in jail. And when they went home the next day, they began planning the second protest. Kids helped too. And this is where the newspaper reporter asked Lydia Finney, or Lydia Wilkins, and her aunt Mabel Grant to go on a secret protest. They both were very light complexioned, and the reporter thought that the ticket taker might not realize that they were Black, which he did not. They went to the park. They enjoyed the rides, and then they left. And the reporter interviewed them, and that was another way of showing that skin color was a ridiculous reason to keep someone out of an amusement park. And I love this illustration because it also shows that there were other families, not just Black families, that felt that segregation needed to come to an end. The Coleman family, Tom, John, and Steve Coleman, along with their parents, went to protest, and their family was arrested. So photos of the boys and their parents being arrested and placed in a police car appeared in the newspapers. Those photos shocked many people, arresting a family for trying to ride a carousel. Ridiculous, I said. Exactly, said Mama. And so again, we can see that the press coverage, which was somewhat unfavorable, and the appearance of children as activists also shook people's consciousness. And on August 28, 1963, my family and I went into Gwynn Oak Amusement Park when it was open to all. This is a rendering of the photograph that you saw earlier. And if you look at the photograph a little bit wider, you can also see that there are white children riding on the carousel on either side of me. And one of the parents approached my dad and asked him if he would help keeping her daughter safe. Now, it's very possible, if you see the actual photograph, the girl looks probably maybe 7 or 8, and she could probably ride on her own. But you know, I think that that was an olive branch being extended to my dad from one parent to another, saying, you know, we're all the same. You're a parent, I'm a parent. Will you keep a watchful eye on my child? I also find it very interesting that the day that the park agreed to integrate was the same day as the March on Washington. And as Amy mentioned earlier, Dr. King was very clear about his dream and his vision for the next generation and the world that he wanted his children to live in. The quote that she shared with you is from a letter from a Birmingham jail. And I often think about why something like integrating an amusement park is important. He talks also about his son's reaction and how he doesn't want his son to become hardened in his heart toward his fellow human being. He doesn't want his child to feel that he's being treated meanly or unkindly because of the color of his skin. And he doesn't want his children's hearts to become hardened to other people. And so, yes, maybe it was just a carousel ride, or maybe it was an opportunity for us to reach out to our greater humanity. The carousel is now in Washington, D.C., near the Lincoln Memorial and not far from the King Memorial. And it's fitting that it should be there, near the monuments that stand for freedom. And so, of course, big kids and little kids, young and old, can ride the carousel. Nobody first, nobody last. Everyone equal, having fun together. So that's just an excerpt from the book. I hope that you enjoyed it. And I do want to show you just this little screen grab from the book. And sometimes, you know, I think we mentioned that I work in elementary education and was a literacy coach for many years. And we think about reading the visual text. So both in Floyd Cooper's illustrations and also the photographs that were part of the reference material, I see families who are saying that this is important to them too. So important that their children were a part of the protest. And that just lets me know that children's voices are valued, right? And so there's the photo that you saw earlier. And before we finish today, and I'm sure in the email links, of course, we'll provide the activities, but I always ask, what are you riding for? What is your justice virtue? Sometimes mine is fairness. Sometimes mine is friendship. But what is your justice value? What are you riding for? And it doesn't have to be related to the amusement park. It can be related to something that's important in our world today, something that you feel needs your attention. And then the same with this line drawing. I love this drawing because if I look at the text, I can place the illustration maybe at an amusement park. Maybe the people are inside the park, or maybe they're outside. I'm not sure. You could decide. And they have signboards, but there's nothing on the sign. So put yourself there. What would you say? And what would you be speaking up for? So thank you for allowing us to share. And thank you for allowing me to call you to a new day of activism. If it's not the amusement park, maybe it's something else that's important to you.
Thank you, Sharon. And thank you, Amy. This was wonderful. We're getting so much great feedback in the chat section. People love Floyd Cooper's illustrations, and they really love what you were saying, Sharon, about what is your justice value. I think we can all take something really meaningful away from that. So thank you for your time. We have a few questions, and we're going to pose one to each of you so that we can hear from you all. And Margot, I think you have one person.
Yeah, and just so you know, just a reminder that we will try to answer all of your questions online and submit them to Amy, Sharon, and Jason to answer, and we'll send a follow-up email. So don't worry about that. But Jason, there are several questions that some people ask, but I'm gonna ask one that maybe even the others, Amy and Sharon, can chime in on. Laurie asked why Gwynn Oak Park was chosen for the protests in particular. So we understand that there were strategic lineups with the date and other events that were going on, like the March on Washington, but why in particular Gwynn Oak in Maryland? Do we have a better idea? Was it location size? Do we have a better idea of why that was?
It was the main amusement park in Baltimore at the time, and it was the most popular one, and schools had picnics and parties there. And also the neighborhood around the park was becoming increasingly African American. So it was even more unfair that local children who lived nearby couldn't come to this very popular amusement park. I actually talked to some parents who lived in the area not far from the park. And this one mother who had very young children at the time said she would drive out of her way when she had her children in the car not to drive past Gwynn Oak because she didn't want to have to explain to them why they couldn't go there. And then she said once the park did open for all, she waited until they were teenagers before she really explained to them why they had never been there before. So really, at that time in 1963, it was the only park in the area.
I see. Yeah, that I can't relate to that, but as a mother, I could. What you just said rings because I'm sure a lot of mothers relate. Like we purposely avoid situations sometimes, so it's just very personal and humanizing in every way. So
yeah. Also, a minister at the time, Reverend Frank Williams, wrote in the Baltimore Sun that he said that Gwynn Oak stood out as a symbol of all the evils inherent in the system of segregation. It was a symbol that had to be faced and challenged because it was such a visible symbol. Yeah.
Jason, do you have anything to add to that? I have a non-Gwynn Oak Park quick question for you, but did you have anything to add about the Gwynn Oak question?
No, I think that hits the nail on the head as to why starting in 1955 that the civic leaders in Baltimore were really, really looking at Gwynn Oak. As for the timing of the 1963, I think that was discussed a little bit too. You know, it was an election season, and the protesters nationally had sort of figured out some strategy at that point. So if you look, they were protesting movie theaters, they were protesting restaurants, and they were protesting Gwynn Oak Park. So it was all the recreation things. I think one of the things that was talked about was, help people feel it in their pocketbooks. And so they chose the places where people went to spend money at the time.
Sure. Real quick, sorry, Martha, real quick. Jason, when you mentioned trolley parks earlier, Joan wanted to ask what that meant quickly. Was that means that the visitors would take a trolley to get to the park, or that trolleys were like a main ride at the park?
Well, trolley parks were owned by the trolley companies. So if you owned a trolley company and you had tracks that went so far and there was nothing at the end of those tracks for people to go to, well, how are you going to get people to use that stretch of your infrastructure? Well, most of the trolley companies also had big electric plants to run the trolley lines. So they would take some of that excess electricity and build an amusement park and use the electricity to run the amusement park and sort of kill two birds with one stone. They were burning off their excess electricity, and now people had a reason to take the trolley to the end of the terminus.
Genius. Sharon, I have a question for you. If you're willing to share, a few people were asking about your parents and why, their role in the civil rights movement. This is a personal question, so if you're willing to share, I think a lot of people would love to hear more about your parents and why they took you to Gwynn Oak Park that day.
You know, I was looking at a few of the questions in the chat, and I want to say that my mother was quite active in civil rights in the late 1950s. And this was right around the time of the Board of Education, Brown versus the Board of Education. My mother grew up in a small town that still had a one-room schoolhouse for the Black students and a comprehensive high school, which was within walking distance of my grandparents' home, which she was not permitted to attend. And my mother, along with several other families, decided that they would help the small county where they lived in Kentucky, that they would help them comply with the law. And so at the time they did, the county did not want to integrate the high school, and they proposed a compromise. They would bus my mother. Now, this is a rural area in Kentucky, so there was not public bus service. My mother rode a bus, like a Greyhound type of bus, from the small county where she lived into Lexington, Kentucky, which had a larger African-American population and had a larger comprehensive high school, which was still for Black students. This is included in Round and Round Together, because I shared this story with Amy. And so for a year, for her senior year in high school, my mother rode the bus every morning from her small town to the bigger city where she could go to a larger comprehensive high school. Well, that wasn't really a solution, because the following year, more families decided, okay, well, we'd like a deal like that too. And of course the cost was prohibitive. So as a result, the county agreed to integrate the high school. Now, when you think about it, my mother was 16 years old when she was willing to do this. So I honestly think that I came about it. I think I came about it kind of honestly. My mother has passed away. But shortly prior to her death, the Civil Rights Museum and the Historical Society in Kentucky honored her for her role. Honored her for her role and her contribution to public education. So, It might be in my veins. What can I tell you?
Well, thank you for sharing that, Sharon, that very personal comment about your mother. So we want to, you're making us all tear up.
You know, I don't talk about it very often, although I'm sure I probably should. But that's why I ask the question, what is your justice value? Because if your justice value is fairness or equality or inclusion or kindness, whatever it might be, then I think that guides your life. I think it guides the choices that you make. And I think it also guides the decisions that you make when it's time to use your voice. And so if you grow up having an opportunity to use your voice and seeing others do that same thing, I think it gives you courage.
These are good words to end our program with, and very powerful words. And from all of you, we just want to thank wonderful experts, historians, and our panelists, and everyone in the audience for sticking with us. We know we're a little over, but a lot of you are still out there, actually. Thank you for supporting us at the Historical Society so that we can continue to give and present free virtual programs like this one that are so very valuable to all of us, and that we're allowed to have Sharon, Amy, and Jason, and allow these stories to be shared and distributed.
Thank you for the invitation. This was wonderful.
Well, yes, thank you. Thank you all. Everyone out there, check out next week's program, Unlocking the Exhibition, The Woman in Forgotten Fight. It'll be very interesting as well. You can register on our website, mdhs.org, or through our Facebook page. And we hope, Martha and I hope, that we see you there. And be well. Bye-bye.
Take care, everyone. Thanks so much.